preach in the Savior's name this morning. I think we always need to keep in mind that it's a privilege that we have to come to the house of God and not a right. We don't have a right to come here because we're members or because we have a certain family name or a certain tradition or belong to a certain denomination. Our only right to come here in the presence of God is because of the blood of Jesus Christ. That's what gives us the privilege, and it is a privilege. So we welcome all the visitors to join us in the privilege, and welcome Nathan back, and welcome us each to the Word of God. That's what we're here for, is to learn more, be reminded of the Word of God. As a clear indication of where our hearts are before God, we as Anabaptist people have often, when we think of nonconformity, we think of dress areas. And definitely, and the way we dress is something that we need to not be conformed to the world. And by the way, just for all of us to keep it clear, the world is not everybody except the Mennonites. The world is not everybody except someone outside of our denomination, except the people inside of our denomination. The world is not everybody except Sequoia Bible Fellowship. That's not what it is. It's not a certain group of people out there that do certain things. It's people who are guided by the prince of the power of the air. It's people who walk in disobedience to the laws and principles of God. That's the world. And if we are doing that in here, if we are living by the principles of the world, then the world is in here. I think we need to keep that clear. And also defining nonconformity. Is nonconformity doing, if we're not conformed to the world, are we then opposite of the world? Is that what nonconformity is? It's simply being opposite from the world. So we look at what the world does over here in this area, whether it's dress, whether it's relationships, and we do opposite of what they're doing. Is that what nonconformity is? In other words, if the world's wavelength is like this, then the Christians, is that nonconformity? Is that how we define nonconformity? Just trying to do it different than what the world does. So if we're going to be nonconformed to the world, and let's turn to our text in Romans chapter 12. Text for this part, I got the message broken up into two parts here, nonconformity and nonresistance. I would just like to, I wouldn't say we're necessarily unbiblical, but I think we're weak as Anabaptist people in thinking in terms of our relationships and thinking in terms of nonresistance and bringing it close enough and not having it, you know, something way out there. Or limited to a certain aspect of our lives. In Romans chapter 12, verse, let's read the first two verses. Let's read this together. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So we said that this is not what nonconformity means, just looking at it, doing it different than what the world does. I think that'll help us. We get that principle. If we help our youth with that principle, it's not just doing the opposite or something different than what the world does. Rather, it is following Christ and whatever, we follow Christ, that's who we're patterning ourselves after. The transformation of our minds is what enables us to do that. Without having our minds transformed, we can look different than the world, but be as far apart from this as we ever were. We can look different, we can seem different, to the world we can look like somebody that's maybe even saintly, but really in our hearts we're not conforming to Christ. When we conform to Christ, that's what makes us different in the world, because the world is conformed to something different. The world is conformed to the enemy's wishes and desires and whims and commandments. And so when we conform ourselves to what Christ wants, that is true nonconformity. Maybe sometimes it won't be that much different from what the world is doing. The world is embracing a principle. But by and large, it will bring us into conflict with the world. Because it's a different path. And people say, well, I don't understand why you are doing this. I just don't, it doesn't make sense. Well, no, we need a transformed mind. That'll make sense. We need to see that we're conforming ourselves to a different wavelength. That's why, and in relationship, that is very important. Again, my burden this morning is that I believe relationships will bring meaning or destroy meaning in life like nothing else. The Bible tells us to be nonconformed in every area of life. And that transformation that Christ works in our hearts then goes out to every area of life, not just dress. Dress is a consequence. Dress is a result of the transformation inside, but it's just one of the results. Let's not forget that one of the results is the Christian's appearance. But it goes into our relationships with our neighbors, our relationships at work, our relationships at home, our relationships amongst the brotherhood. It ought to be different amongst Christians. And too often it's not. And I think it's part of this losing the what God really wants in our relationships of nonconformity. I'd like us to pay more attention to being nonconformed in our relationships and how we view and relate to conflict. 1 Peter 1:14 says, as obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former lusts in your ignorance. Now, there's a way of fashioning ourselves. The world does it. The world follows a wavelength. All of us do. None of us are original enough to follow our own wavelength. We are following someone's wavelength. Christ appeals to us in the scriptures here to fashion ourselves to Christ and not to the world's wavelength. And I'd like to just look at 6 points that we are to be nonconformed in, where this practical areas where this nonconformity shows up. In John chapter 13, looking at a number of scriptures. John chapter 13, verse 34 and 35. Let's start at verse 33. Little children, yet a little while I am with you. Ye shall seek me, and as I said unto the Jews, whither I go ye cannot come. So now I say to you, a new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. I'm not going to be here. Do you know the kind of love I had towards you? You have that towards one another. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have loved one to another. As I mentioned before, there is no other place in scriptures where it makes such a clear delineation, such a clear definition of what it looks like. What are the differences? How people are going to tell as our relationships, how we relate together as brothers and sisters. And if there's not love, if there's not harmony and unity within the body of Christ, we have no witness. We have nothing to offer to the world if we can't work it on a practical level. By this shall all men know. And I don't think it's something that we have to, you know, give the people around us a big explanation or a big seminar on exactly how this looks. They know. They know whether we as a community have love and harmony or if there's disunity. They just do. I have lived in a number of different communities, and it's just always that way. People know what's happening within the body of Christ. Maybe not all the details, but they know if there's animosity or if there's love. It's a distinguishing mark. And do you know that love, no other religion has this as its distinguishing mark. Christianity has this as its distinguishing mark, earmark. 1 John 4:20. 1 John 4:20. If a man say, I love God, and hateth his brother, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother whom he hath seen, how can he love God whom he hath not seen? To me, it's a principle that it shows us what our relationship with God is like. You look at this, and you know what the relationship with God is like. It's a little like an oil gauge in a vehicle. You see the oil gauge. You don't see all what's happening down in there. But you can look at this oil gauge, and as long as there's a connection there, you can see what's going on in there. You can tell whether the oil pressure is good or whether oil pressure is low. And by our horizontal relationships, we can tell what our spiritual relationship, our relationship with God is. In John 17, it's different. The Christian is to be different than the world and his responses in the way we relate to each other. There ought to be a separation. There ought to be a nonconformity there that's not existent in the world. In 1 John 17, verse 20, neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory which thou gavest me I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one, I in them, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one. I in them, and thou in me. I in them, and thou in me. I was struck with that yesterday. Christ in us. If Christ is in me, and if Christ is in my brother, do you see for us to be in conflict, for us to be backbiting each other, for us to be gossiping about each other, for us to be destroying each other with our tongues. You see how incompatible that is? See how Christ isn't going to live with that. Christ in us, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and again that the world may know that thou hast sent me. I take this prayer as a promise. I take this prayer as a proof that it is possible. Christ doesn't pray something impossible for us, does he? And he's praying to God that they may be one. And as that, as we yield, as we are transformed in our minds, that becomes a reality. In 1 John 4:19, I'll just read that verse, short verse. We love him because he first loved us. The only way we love Christ is because we have first received his love. Unless we receive that love, we cannot love him, and we will not love each other. And that's different. That's a transformation that takes place in our minds. When we're conformed to this world, we will try to do it in our own strength. We will try to, the world tries to whip itself up, to try to prove to itself or try to prove to others that we have that love. And the Christian receives that love from Christ. And the automatic result of receiving that love is giving out love. The verse is so profound. We cannot earn God's love. We cannot do certain things, you know, dress just a certain way, just work things, you know, have family worship every morning and just kind of gain some brownie points and gain God's love. Well, I see this family here is having family worship every morning, or he's reading his Bible every day, or, you know, he stopped and helped that needy person. So, I think I'll just dish out a little bit of my love here. It's not that way. You can't earn God's love. It's a free gift that he gives. Now, you have a choice of whether you want to receive it or not. And the working out in our life is a proof of that. Romans chapter 5. Let's turn to that. Romans chapter 5, verse 6. For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die. Yet, peradventure, for a good man, some would even dare to die. But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, he demonstrates his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And that's true of every one of us. There's none of us that are exempt from that. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. It wasn't after we were righteous. It wasn't after we had done a certain things. It wasn't after we had achieved a certain status in a congregation or in a home or in our own minds or in God's mind. God died. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. And sinners are those who are in rebellion against God. Christ died for us while we were in that condition. Can we say that he died for us and applies to us because there's something special that we did? And I think that's profound, that being nonconformed in our love because we have received God's love. Number two is the way we view God, being nonconformed in the way we view God. Do we have a biblical view of God? I touched on that some at the beginning. But do we look biblically at who God is, and what his nature is, and what he has said about what his children will experience? Because it will affect our obedience and our trust. You know, if I can't trust God, God says to do this. But I just really can't quite trust. No, but what about this situation? You know, it's just, I can see that over here, but here, I don't think so. I don't think that would be a wise, you see what we're doing? We're not trusting God. We're not believing in God. And so because our view of God is too low, then we choose to disobey. I mean, we'll go so far, but after that, we won't. That is how the world thinks. You know, yeah, sometimes it makes sense, and yeah, when it makes your business increase, and when it pays off, and when it kind of lines up with what I want to do, then yeah, we can go along with it. But when it's in direct contrast to my will, when it's completely different, and God says this clearly, we'll run across a couple of those later on. When God says that we are to do this in this situation, and we say, I don't think so. That can't be right. That just wouldn't work. You see how our view of God affects our relationship, our obedience, and our trust. And then we ought to be nonconformed as the people of God, as Christians, in how we view suffering. Is suffering compatible with God? Some of you children, somebody want to answer that. Is suffering compatible with God? Does God and suffering go together? Why? Somebody want to tell me why God and suffering goes together. How do you know that that's true? Older ones?
How do we know that God and suffering are compatible? It's not like, well, there must not be a God if we're suffering. All that will live godly lives in Christ Jesus can expect to suffer persecution. Nowhere in the scriptures does it say that the Christian will not experience suffering,
will not experience the loss of family approval, will not experience the loss of the loss of his possessions at times. And I think we're more affected by that health and wealth gospel than what we realize. And it has affected how I've read the Bible for years, and I'm trying to get that out. I'm trying to see it differently, because God never does promise to the New Testament Christian that he will not suffer. Rather, he promises that he will suffer. And that happens in the bride of Christ sometimes. We suffer, and it's not, we can handle it out there. You know, we can handle out there when a neighbor misuses us or mistreats us, we can, we're Christians, we'll just do the right thing. But when it comes from my own brother, when it comes from my own sister, then I just don't have any time for it. And I'd like to remind us this morning that transformation of the mind goes all the way through all of our relationships. It affects how we relate in all of our relationships. Number three is the way we view ourselves and each other. We are to be non-conformed in how we view ourselves. How do we see ourselves? We are told all around us that we need to whip up our self-esteem. I mean, think good about yourself. Don't think that you're a no-gooder. Don't think that you're a nobody. You are somebody. And we need to have self-esteem. I wonder what you say if I ask that's right. Is that true? We need to have self-esteem? Somebody tell me. What do you think? Does a person need self-esteem to make it in life? I mean, can you get by without self-esteem? Not a trick question, just, if you think if you need it, say it. How have you been operating? Have you been trying to, or have you not faced that yet? God hears the cry of the humble. And humility and self-esteem doesn't go together. Is that what you're saying? Or do y'all agree with that? We don't need self-esteem? Turn to Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I think it puts it so beautifully. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I, or self, is crucified with Christ. How about esteeming that self? Esteeming the I. It's supposed to be crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. And I think we need to differentiate for that. Sometimes we call it self-esteem, and maybe we're meaning the right thing, but let's be careful about that. Because the self-esteem of, you know, I'm somebody. After all, I can. After all, I have, you know, after all, I have these abilities, and after all, God has given me this. And I think it could be as pride and as wrong. It can be conformed to the world. Being non-conformed is realizing that in me dwells no good thing. And that Christ calls me to crucify self, not to esteem self. Christ calls me to crucify myself. Now, because I am God's and I have surrendered to God's, I have lost the right either to lift myself up in pride or to degrade myself. I am a creation of Christ. I am created by God. I am his creature. And he makes all things good. He saw that it was good and didn't just stop with what he saw there. He saw that what he had made and it was good. And I think when a little baby is born, when our little baby was born, God said it was good. And your baby too, for that matter. God still creates him as he wants him, and he gifts him as he wants him. And we have lost the right. When we surrender to Christ and self is crucified, we have lost the right to either lift ourselves up in pride or to degrade ourselves, because we are in Christ Jesus. Christ is living in me. We're vessels. We're temples. It's not all about us. It's all about Christ. And I think that will give us an esteem, the proper esteem that will carry us. Because if you have self-esteem, it's a matter of you trying to lift yourself up. And as long as nobody else blows it away, you're okay. As soon as somebody else comes by and blows it away, you're down in the dumps again. But when you see that it's something that Christ gives you, by virtue of creation and by virtue of salvation, no one can take that away from you. Your dignity, no one can take away from you. We are to be nonconformed in how we think about that.
2 Corinthians 5:15, jot this verse down. And he that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. And that is a noble cause to live for. Remember the story of the Pharisee versus the publican. The Pharisee went up and said, I thank God I don't like this. That is conformed to this old world. That's how the world thinks. I'm glad I'm not like them. I'm glad I'm not like... And religious people are caught up in that. You know, I'm glad. Just stand over here a little bit. You're just a little too holy for you. That is not the lowliness of the mind of Christ. Romans says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. What does all mean there? It means all, doesn't it? All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Doesn't matter how you were raised. Doesn't matter what you didn't get involved in. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Which means that we, as with a transformed mind, we see that. We see that we have sinned and come short of the glory of God, and we needed the mercy of God just like anybody else did. And it affects how we view others. It affects how we view ourselves. Simple sinners saved by grace. Are sinners that are saved by grace saints? I'm not trying to just bring a bunch of trick questions here. I'd like to impact the way we think. Are sinners who are saved by grace saints? Yes, they are. Saints are none other than those who have been saved by grace. The only way we can be saved. Philippians chapter 2, verse 3. I just bless God for the simplicity of the Word of God and for its profundity. And we get so used to reading it sometimes, it's not necessary. It's not necessary that we draw apart and don't read the Bible for a while, so we don't. We just need to pay attention. We just need to have the Holy Spirit guiding us as we read, and it will help us to see some of these things. It says, verse 3 of Philippians 2, let nothing, and again, what does nothing mean? Nothing. Is that clear enough? You know what nothing means? When, that'd be a good illustration. When mom says, clear the table. I want nothing on the table. What does that mean? Nothing on the table, does it? You might have a question whether she wants to take the tablecloth off or not, but probably not. She just wants no dishes or anything on the table. It's nothing. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind let each esteem other better than themselves. And that's a rule for every Christian. That's a rule for Sequoia Bible Fellowship, is let nothing be done through strife or vainglory. Nothing that we do. Nothing justifies being done by strife and vainglory. But you don't know what... No, nothing. Be done through strife and vainglory. But in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. In lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. That's tough. That's a challenge. In lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. Do you esteem others better than yourself? My idea's got to go, or else. I just don't think I could be wrong. Now, we know that we stand on Scripture, but when we stand on Scripture, it's not because it can be, but it shouldn't be because we esteem our own opinion, but rather because we esteem God's opinion. Let each esteem others better than themselves. And we're different. The world does not esteem others better than themselves unless there's an advantage for me in it. Unless I get something out of it. And the Christian is to esteem others better than themselves. Different in the way we view each other. We're nonconformed, that we don't use each other as a measuring stick for holiness. You know, brother so-and-so is not the measure of holiness. Now, if I measure up to that, I'm okay. If I don't measure up to that, I'm not okay. This is the measure of holiness that Christian has. We're not measuring sticks. We can be examples. We can be encouragement to each other. But we're not really the finally... There's no brother here. There's no pastor here that's finally the measure of how we will be judged in Judgment Day. So we look at each other that way. Number 5 is in how we resolve conflict. We will face conflict. We'll run across those times when there's conflict. We're not seeing eye to eye. Somewhere something is keeping us from seeing eye to eye. Romans 12:18 says, if it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. And I just simply take that to mean that you give it all you've got. You give it all you've got. Romans 14:19, let us therefore follow after the things which make for peace, and things wherewith one may edify another. Let us therefore follow after the things which make for peace, and things wherewith one may edify another. That is the mind of Christ. That is what we are to conform ourselves to. That if it be possible, as much as lies in us, we will live peaceably. We will go the extra mile. We would rather give up some of our earthly possessions. We'd rather give up some of our savings account than to be conformed to the world and follow their way of dealing with it.
And is it, do we do all we can to live peaceably?
And I know there's this thing around about, you know, well, if you can't get along, if you don't see eye to eye, just do part ways. Don't fuss. Don't fight. There is some truth to that, but I'd like to warn us against that kind of a philosophy. I think the Bible says we should try the best we can to work it out. We should be committed. We're committed to working it out. We need each other. Rather than just parting ways every time we have a little disagreement. Hebrews 12:14, follow peace with all men and holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. Following peace with all men is different. It's not just the little close clique we have. It's not just our best friends. We kind of try to keep that on. But follow peace with all men. Everyone you relate to, follow peace. Well, I believe the Christian is to be nonconformed in his commitment to work through conflict, to biblical, peaceful resolution. And right there lies one of the, you know, in the world, the way the world thinks is if you run into a little conflict in a marriage, you just part ways and you find a better one. You just find somebody who you don't have that conflict with. Biblically, that's not what Christ told us. He says we are to live peaceably. We are to give it all we've got to live peaceably. Work it out. And our commitment to working through that. Number 4 is our responses. Let's turn to Luke chapter 6. Number 5, I'm sorry. I think I got that crossed up. Number 4 was responses. Number 5 is in how resolve conflict. Our responses. The Christian is to be nonconformed in his responses. In Luke chapter 6, verse 32. For if you love them which love you, what thank have ye? For sinners also love those that love them. And if you do good to them which do good to you, what thank have ye? For sinners also do even the same. And if ye lend to them who of whom ye hope to receive, what thank have ye? For sinners also lend to sinners to receive as much again. In other words, he's saying if you can get along when everything's going good, what's that different? The world can do that. The person who doesn't have a transformed mind can do that. The test is when we have disagreements, when there are conflicts, how we relate to them. And that happens within the brotherhood. We are sometimes not treated like we ought to be treated. We're not sometimes not treated in a maybe somebody says something about us. Well, if we can be nice and we can go along with church life as long as everybody just speaks nice about us and everything is okay, then there is no substance to our Christianity. God gives us ways to work through that. God gives us instruction how to work through that. But the real test of Christianity is when we are confronted with opposition. We're confronted with conflict, and what are our responses there? But love your enemies. Don't just do good to those who are good to you. Don't just give where you know you'll receive back. It says, love your enemies, and do good, and lend hoping for nothing again. And your reward shall be great, and you shall be the children of the highest. For he is kind unto the unthankful and to the holy. Be ye therefore merciful, as your Father also is merciful. Judge not. Sorry, I'm going to stop reading there. Verse 35, but love ye your enemies, and do good, and lend hoping for nothing again. And your reward shall be great, and ye shall be children of the highest. And I think in Matthew it says, that ye may be children. That's why we do it, that we may be children of God. Not because, just because I think that's what's going to make this work. I think it's that's way everything's going to turn out okay. I won't lose anything. I respond this way because it's really not worth. It's that we're the children of our Heavenly Father. That is why we respond this way. And then number 6. The Christian is to be nonconformed in how he views and relates to position or position seeking. And that is something that creates a lot of conflict at times. Matthew 20:25. Jesus called his disciples unto them, and he said, you know that the princes of the Gentiles, and he's talking about the world system, the way the world operates, is that the princes of Gentiles exercise dominion over them, and they that are great exercise authority upon them. In other words, out here,
In the world, you seek position. You seek to elevate yourself. You put others down to get to the top. Not so. You're to be nonconformed in this area. Shall not be so among you, but whosoever will be the great among you, let him be your minister. And the servant heart is so tied to being Christ-like. It's so connected.
John chapter 13, what we call the foot washing scripture. Jesus said, I wash your feet. You should do like I do. Happy are you if you do these things. I came to serve. I am among you as one that serveth. Luke 22.
I came among you as one that serveth. That's the mind of Christ. Brothers and sisters, it takes a servant heart to work through conflict. You know, even if we get into a conflict, and if I am trying to just make my life easier, if I'm just trying to make so that I just can't stand this. I mean, it just gets me. So let's get together and let's try to work something out here because I can't live with this. Or is it a servant heart? Is it trying to serve? How can I serve my brother? How can I be a blessing? I think that concept was involved in the principle that Nathan talked about. What do we do with someone with a family member that has committed suicide? How do we relate to the other people? Or somebody who has attempted suicide? It's that servant heart. It's compassion. How can I serve? How can I help? And now non-resistance in relationships. Again, we're non-resistance. We think right away of not going to war, and we don't go over to Iraq, and we're conscientious objectors. We don't fight, we don't kill, and so we get into these conversations with the neighbors. But look, if somebody would come to your house and try to destroy your family, they make up this hypothetical situation. What would you do? Oh, no, I couldn't kill. I couldn't. Are we truly non-resistant? Non-resistance goes in how we talk about each other. Non-resistance is evidenced by how we think about each other. That is where the heart of non-resistance comes. Yes, maybe we can avoid some of those things, but not be non-resistant. I would like to emphasize that non-resistance goes to the core of our being and affects everything we do, not just whether we go to war or not. Not just whether we shoot somebody that comes into our home or not. Turn to Romans chapter 12. The same chapter that we started out with there. Be not conformed, but be transformed. He makes this simple statement. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. Vengeance is whose? It's God's. Vengeance is mine. Well, he just took that right out of our hands, didn't he? Vengeance is God. It's not that God does not set the record straight. It's not that we shouldn't be concerned. But God has said that it's not up to you to set the record straight. When someone wrongs you, it is not up to you to make sure that he gets paid sufficiently. It's not up to you that to see to it that he gets rewarded or he gets that he suffers a penalty for that. That's not up to us. The Christian has no right. God just took that right out of that hand. Now, if I tell you that these are my keys, these are my keys. They're my keys. They're not yours. I use them. If you need to borrow them, I'll let you borrow them. If you tell me what you want to get into or whatever's behind the lock. But God never loans that vengeance. Now, he uses men. He uses men who are not... He uses kings. He uses rulers to mete out that vengeance. But he's taken it out of the Christian. That's the world. God has taken it out of the Christian's hands. Vengeance is his. God will set the record straight. It's not a matter of whether things will be set straight or not, but whose job is it? Vengeance is mine, he says. You know, the sword has never yet conquered a human heart. Force has never yet conquered a human heart. Whether it's as parents, as children, as church leaders, using force never wins the heart. And yes, when children are young, we need to restrain them. But as adults, relating on an adult level, force never conquers the heart. And if you don't have the heart, you really don't have anything. You have very little if you don't have the heart. If you've got the heart, you've got it all. And I believe that this issue of non-resistance is one of the issues that makes it so difficult for us as churches to work out our difficulties.
We get into a squeeze. We get into a bind. We have disagreements. And yeah, we come from different backgrounds. And we have, a scenario comes up here, and I just look at it differently. I mean, I just don't agree with the way you're seeing it. Well, that is an issue that needs to be worked through. But when we are not non-resistant, when we are resist, and we use our tongues, we resist each other, the problems multiply. And then it gets very difficult to deal with the core issue because we are resistant and complicates it a lot. I think we need to guard our hearts very carefully because it comes very close home. Some ways we can return evil for evil in our relationships is withdrawing from a relationship. I just won't relate. I'll just leave. Silence. I refuse to talk. I won't talk to him. I'll just go the other way. Anger. Backbiting. Have you ever seen somebody do backbiting? You ever seen backbiting? Children know what backbiting means? Ever seen that? You ever seen that? Where have you seen that? Simply talking behind somebody else's back. It's simply criticizing someone else. It's talking negatively about someone else. We haven't talked with them. It doesn't solve anything. It's biting them. It's biting them behind the back. Gossiping is not an unresistant activity. Withholding forgiveness does not stem from an unresistant heart. Doing things on purpose to disappoint or to hurt those we are at odds with is not an unresistant heart. It does not come from an unresistant heart. And, you know, we're human, and we can see that over here. But this situation, I just don't think this principle applies. You don't know what this person's done to me. You don't understand how much I have been hurt. You don't understand how he wronged me, and he knew it. He knew what I wanted. He knew what I didn't want, and he did it or didn't do it, and he did this purposely because, okay, let's make a bad scenario. It is bad. Okay, let's call that enemies, right? Does anybody have a category that's worse than enemies? You think of a category that's worse than enemy? Like somebody could get beyond this person, this group of people over here, they're enemies. But these people over here, they're beyond enemies. Is there anything like that? I don't know of anything like that. That's the worst case scenario. Is an enemy. What's the Bible just say to do to your enemy? Worst case scenario.
Love.
Pray for? And another one. I think Bible means what it says. Can't be more simple than that. And when we, as brothers, as a brotherhood, find ourselves in conflict, just keeping those principles in mind will make a difference most of the time. Husband and wife, parent, child, neighbor. Number two, we need to recognize that the tongue can be used as a weapon. If we want to be non-resistant, we need to recognize that not carrying a gun, not having a sword, not carrying knives, not carrying weapons of mass destruction, all of us carry a weapon of much destruction in our mouth. And every one of you, I have not seen them, but I am confident that every one of you have a weapon of much destruction in your mouth this morning. You don't have to show it to me. I'm not questioning that. But our tongue, we can use our tongue as a weapon of much destruction. Psalms 52:2. The tongue deviseth mischiefs like a sharp razor working deceitfully. Proverbs 12:18. There is that speaketh like the piercings of a sword, but the tongue of the wise is health. Proverbs 18:21. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. James 3, brother read those scriptures this morning, raises the issue of the tongue and tells us how big a matter it can kindle. Do you realize how non-resistance affects how we use this little thing in here? Non-resistance affects how we speak about each other. And gossip, like I said earlier, is not a non-resistant activity. Gossip I'd like to define as talking about another person's faults or failures with a person who is neither part of the problem or the solution. To talk about another person's faults or failures with a person who's neither a part of the problem or the solution. And I just like that. I think, brothers, when we get into a conflict and gossip starts coming around and we start gossiping about each other and talking behind our backs, I think we need to bow our hearts and confess before God our sin of being resistant. We are not non-resistant in heart. Too many times, people feel good because I dress a certain way or because I'm holding to this belief and I think this is right. But we're not non-resistant. We're not truly non-resistant. A few quotes. A gossip usually makes a mountain out of a molehill by adding some dirt. Gossip is a sort of smoke that comes from the dirty tobacco pipes of those who diffuse it. It proves nothing but the bad taste of the smoker. I want us to get that. When we gossip, we are telling more about ourselves than we're telling about the other person. To think about that. Process that and make that a part of how you think. When I gossip, when I talk, when I am gossiping about other people, I am saying more about myself than I am saying about other people. Albert Simpson said, I would rather play with forked lightning or take in my hands living wires with a fiery current than speak a reckless word against any servant of Christ or idly repeat the slanderous darts which thousands of Christians are hurling on others to the hurt of their own souls and bodies. Number three, we need to follow God's plans rather than man's schemes. We as a Christian who have been transformed, we need to follow God's plan rather than trying to scheme. How are we going to relate to this? Romans chapter 12, verse 17, if you want to jot that verse down, recompense to no man evil for evil. Recompense to no man evil for evil. Now which man does that allow us to recompense evil to? No man. Recompense to no man. When somebody does me evil, I never have the right to return evil. The Bible just simply takes that completely out of the transformed mind, out of the transformed life. Romans 12:21, be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. 1 Thessalonians 5:15, see that none render evil for evil unto any man, but ever follow that which is good, both among yourselves and to all men. It's so easy. You know, when somebody, we hear that somebody says something about us, a brother or somebody comes and says, hey, do you know what he's saying about you? Or so-and-so said that you have, and right away, we are tested whether we're non-resistant or not. And we say a little something to just, you know, just bring a little pain, just something back, just to get even a little bit, just to, that's an evil for evil relationship. That's an evil for evil response. And scriptures forbid us that. 1 Peter 3:8-9. Finally, be all of one mind, having compassion one of another, love as brethren. Be pitiful, be courteous, not rendering evil for evil or railing for railing, but contrariwise blessing, knowing that you are thereunto called that you should inherit a blessing. Not rendering evil for evil or railing for railing. When you hear something bad said about you, say something good in return. Maybe you need to go talk to that individual. Bible does not forbid us to go and try to understand what he's saying. Or God, let the brother know that he did something wrong. But we never return evil. We never give evil. We never give evil back. And a railing comes our way, we give a blessing. That's Christ-like. Study his life and you will see that. And I would just like to remind us that it's not a naive approach. What do you think? Somebody says, just really says some nasty words and says some gossip and then you bless. That's not a naive approach. That is the most likely way to result in reconciliation and harmony in relationships. And it reveals whose children we are. The Bible does not say that we're just to go like this. Whenever something bad happens, whenever somebody speaks evil, whenever something does bad, when somebody steals something, when somebody speaks evil, when somebody smashes our reputation, when somebody makes us feel about this big, the Bible does not say, just put your hands behind your back and just go away and just don't do anything. But rather, in 1 Corinthians 10:3, it says, though we walk in the flesh, in other words, we have physical bodies, we have flesh and bone, we do not war after the flesh, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. God tells us what to do, but our weapons are not carnal. We don't go to war, not because we're just too lazy or too scared, but that's not what our weapons are. That's not how the weapon, the warfare that we're involved in, that's not how you fight it with swords and bombs. That's not how you do it. We have other weapons, and God forbid that we refuse to go to war and we just make money.
but rather that we be a truly non-resistant and wield the weapons that God has given us.
And number four is we need to heap on coals of fire. Turn to Romans chapter 12 again. Romans has a lot of verses that pertains to our subject this morning. Let's read some of those verses again. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. Therefore, let an enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink, for in so doing thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. How do we heap coals of fire on his head? I'm sure I've said that before, but for years I was just puzzled about this, you know. I thought it probably meant, like, it makes him ashamed. Like, one time in Costa Rica, we had somebody steal some of our, no, it wasn't us, it was one of the brothers in church. They had their, I think it was that Sunday, they had lunch cooking on the stove, and they took lunch, and they took all their most of the dishes that they got as wedding gifts, they just took it off. Took it out. They got these little kettles, you know, you do pressure cookers that you cook beans in. Most of you have those pressure cookers. They got this little thing, you close it, and it's got the little jiggler on top. I don't know what you call it, but it goes as the beans are getting ready. And they forgot to take that thing. They didn't take that thing. So, but they took the other thing. Well, you know that kettle's no good without that. You can't use it for what's intended. So this brother took this jiggler. He found out who it was, and he took this little jiggler, and he gave him the jiggler. And I looked at this verse, and I just, well, that probably means that, you know, he'd be ashamed of himself. And he's just like, you know, maybe repent, maybe just, but you know, there can be there can be carnality there. Here's a jiggler. Sir, I know who did it. I know you did it. You were the one that did it. Here's a jiggler. What kind of man are you? And what kind of man am I? As I understand it, the Jews understood this as simply bringing the blessing of God. Coals of fire were the presence of God. They were symbolic of the presence of God. And I believe that's what he's saying. And where all that other ties in, I'm not sure. But I believe he's saying, for in so doing, you bring the presence of God into the situation. You don't, if your enemy is hungry, some of you have read that story where this man was sleeping in bed, and early one morning he heard some thumping around on his roof. And he went outside, and here was some of his, he was a pastor, and somebody got upset at him, something he preached, something he did somewhere. And they were outside, they're taking the thatch roof off. Most of you read that story, haven't you? A lot of you? It's in Coals of Fire, I think is the book. And so he went in and woke up his wife and told his wife to get breakfast ready. And killed the fatted calf, as it were, and made a good breakfast. And he went out there and called the man, hey, breakfast is ready. Okay. That's not quite what I was expecting. Took them in, gave them a good breakfast. And I think it wasn't just to shame them. It shouldn't be just to shame them. But that's how the presence of God came in the situation. Whenever we get into conflict, whenever we get into a situation that's just, we're not getting along. Let's stop and consider. Now, how can I be transformed? How can I be Christ-like? How can I bring the presence of God into this situation rather than repaying evil for evil? You know, arguments, hot arguments, just cannot thrive on that kind of thing. It takes an evil for evil argument for that thing to escalate. You know, where we get heated, whenever you get into a heated argument where you just tit for tat and accusing each other, that's an evil for evil relationship. It's sin. God calls us to bring the presence of God into the situation. And how can we bring the presence of God into a situation if we're not experiencing it ourselves? That's why we need to be transformed. In summary, nonconformity and nonresistance pierce deep into our home and church relationships. Our obedience or disobedience has long-reaching consequences for us and our children. Scriptures say, as much, if it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. And having said this, I don't want to sweep, with these last statements, I don't want to sweep everything away that I've said, but it does take two to build a bridge. It's just so neat the way the scriptures are set up. It says, if it be possible. In recognition that sometimes it's not possible. But folks, if we are the party that's responsible for the not possible, we have to answer for that judgment day. If we are not responsible, if it was not possible to bring reconciliation, biblical reconciliation, then and we have done all we could to bring the presence of God, that goes home with them. We don't need to be guilty the rest of our lives. We can leave that in God's hands. May God help us as a congregation, as individuals, to teach our children, to live that out before Him, that we are committed to be non-resistant and non-conformed in these details that Christ has lined out for us. Let's pray.